Hello everyone and welcome to day 5 of learning Illustrator. First of all, let's see what all we did in day 4. Yeah, so firstly we covered about guides and rulers part 2. Now by this time you should know why I call this part 2, because we have covered some part of it in day 3 and then we left some part and then we covered it in day 4 and we did it intentionally so that we can divide some complex topics into 2 videos and make it easy to digest or easy to understand for everyone. Okay, so then we learned about artboards and when we create a new file. So what all options do we get about artboards at that time? All right, and then we learned about artboard panel. So this was like a separate panel for artboards and there was hell lot of options in that and we covered all of them. And then finally we jumped to artboard options. So like we get a separate window which has all the options about the artboards and you can modify your artboard in any way you want. Okay, so let's see what all we are going to learn today. So today, first of all, we will learn about artboard tool. Now, we were supposed to cover this tool in day 4 video. Again, we were running short on time. So that's why we decided to cover it in day 5. Now, again, I could have covered it in day 4. But since I wanted to keep video length about 1 hour intentionally, I don't want to go like 1 hour 20 minutes or 1 hour 30 minutes. Because this actually tool could have taken some 15 to 20 minutes of time. So that's why I intentionally skipped that part for day 4 and I thought I'll cover it in day 5. But anyways, that is no problem at all. So then we are going to look at exporting artboards. So, but I'm still not sure about this thing. I think we should cover it when we actually learn about how to export our artworks. Like if you create something and you want to save it as a JPG or a PNG format image, then at that time, if you learn this, this makes more sense. So I think for now, we will just skip it for this chapter and we will cover it when we actually learn about how exporting works. Then in the first time, we will actually learn about how to draw or how to draw your own shapes in Illustrator. So like today, we will learn about 3 shapes, rectangle, rounded rectangle and ellipse. And then we will learn about selection tool. So if you draw some shape, you should know how selection tool works along with it. Then only it makes sense. Otherwise, your shapes will be all over the place. Okay. And then we'll learn about how to fill color in shapes and how to change their outline colors and change the outline weight. And then we will learn about grouping and ungrouping. Now, if you have worked on Word or PowerPoint or any of these kind of softwares before, then you must be familiar with this term grouping and ungrouping, and it almost works the same way here in Illustrator. There are few in Illustrator you get a deeper control over this, so yeah, that's the only difference. And then we will learn about how to lock and hide objects. Now we have learned how to lock and hide guides in day 4. Today we are going to see how can we do same thing with objects or the shapes like rectangle, rounded rectangle and ellipse. So let's jump into Illustrator without wasting any further time, and there we go. I'm just creating a new file here. I choose artboard options, number of artboards at Z1 and size is B4. That's good for me. Unit is inches and there's no bleed at all. I don't need it. Mode is portrait and CMY. I'll choose RGB instead this time. Now it has given me some warning. Again, we will cover all these things when we learn about colors in Illustrator. So let us just click OK for now and there we go. We have our file. So now let's see what options and what all we can do when we use artboard tool. So far we have seen artboard options from here. When we create a new file, I can change number of artboards and I can change the orient, the layout, the spacing and number of rows and columns from here. Then we learned about this artboard panel, that what all options do we get from this artboard panel, like we can rename the artboard and we can go to artboard options from here, and then we went to all these options like delete artboard, duplicate artboard and all those things, and then we learned about all these buttons, and we know that we can drag and drop, like we can drag and drop objects in here, create a duplicate artboard. All this we learned, all this we covered in day 4 actually. So I'm not going to repeat again and again the same thing. So today we will learn about artboard tool. So let us select the artboard tool first. You can either click on this kind of icon in your toolbar, or you can press shift 0 on your keyboard to select that artboard tool. So there I go, I have my artboard tool selected. Now again, you can immediately notice a difference that there is a bounding box around it. These 6 dots, I think these are not 6, these are 8 dots, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, 8 dots around our artboard, and there is a central dot which defines the central position of our artboard. Okay. So yeah, let's select again the artboard tool and let's see what changes do we get. So shift 0. Now to start with, let me actually create a file with multiple artboards. So file new, and let's say I will have 3 artboards in here. Let us just change it to CMY. Okay, that's better. And arrangement is column wise. I like column wise better than row. Okay, so we have our artboard tool selected already, and so it says that my artboard 1 is selected right now. Again, we can change our selection from here, and you can see the bounding box is shifting from artboard to artboard. Okay, so now coming to the functionality of artboard tool, you can click and drag on the artboard and you can change its position. So how simple is that now? Previously we had to go to artboard options and then we could change our X and Y positions from here. And you exactly, the problem with this system is you don't know where your artboard position will be. I mean, I can go and say 12 pixels, but you don't know where exactly, sorry, 12 inches, but you don't know exactly where this 12 inches will land and where will your artboard be repositioned. So unless you press tab, you don't have exact idea. And let's say I don't want it here. I want to be very precise about it. So I change it to 11.5 then. And again, I'm like, no, this is not the exact position which I want, because I am not getting a live preview first of all. So this is an excellent tool for that. I mean, I can just click and drag and I get a real life position of where my artboard will be placed, and that is really convenient for me. So again, I can click on artboard anywhere is fine, and I can drag to reposition my artboard. Yeah, so since we are talking about repositioning, there is an additional advantage that we get with repositioning. So let us see. While moving your artboard, let's say you just clicked here, and while moving your artboard, if you press Alt on your keyboard, so you can notice a difference. My cursor actually changed from a single, you can say this move icon or arrow, to this copied arrows, two arrows, one black and one white. This actually means that I am copying the stuff, so I am duplicating the artboard over here. So when I release my mouse and then release the Alt key, so I have a duplicated artboard. I can do this again. Let us click over here and drag. Now before releasing our mouse, or just press Alt in between, then release our mouse and then release Alt. Don't release Alt before, otherwise it will not work. So let's say this time I released Alt before and then I released mouse. So it moved my artboard instead. So if you want to copy your artboard or duplicate your artboard, so all you have to do is click and move on the artboard and then press Alt and release the mouse first and then release the Alt key. So there I have 6 artboards now instead of 3. I just duplicated all of this. Now again, I'm getting copies of this here, so if I want to rename, I can rename it from here. So okay, so this is how you can copy your artboard along with your navigation. Okay, fair enough. Now let's see how can we resize or rescale our artboard using artboard tool. So I'm selecting artboard 1. Oh, by the way, if you want to select any of your artboard and you want to modify any of your artboard, you can just select this artboard tool and click on any of them. You need not to select from here artboard panel. You can absolutely avoid them. Even you can close it, that's no problem. But I'm just opening it for the sake of more information over here. So yeah, I can click on any of this artboard to select the active artboard. And now I have this bounding box around. So how this bounding box works is if you go into any of this middle, let me zoom it a bit. Yeah, if you go into any of this middle points, then you have your cursor change to a horizontal or vertical scaling cursor. So you can click on this point and drag around to scale your artboard. Or actually it is resize, I think. Let me just confirm it for you guys. Let me just confirm it. I'll just draw a rectangle and you will see, is it actually scaling or is it resizing? Yeah, it is actually resizing my artboard. It's not scaling. But scaling means actually my artwork, this rectangle should also be scaled along with the artboard. But this is not scaling. It is just resizing my artboard and it doesn't affect my drawing at all. So my drawing stays the same, your artboard changes the shape, sorry, size. So let us see again. Yeah, so we were seeing about horizontal resizing of the artboard. So you can click on any of these two boxes around or points and you can click and drag to resize in horizontal direction. Then the same way vertical one works, so you can click and drag on any of these middle ones and drag it in vertical direction, the top and the bottom one, both works the same way. Now you have this corner points, four corner points. So these are for, I think by now it's very clear that if I click and drag it, we will have a full control, I mean both the directions. We can either resize it in vertical direction or horizontal direction at the same time. So yeah, I am just gonna resize it to this much. Now you can say that I want to scale it in proportions. What if I want to scale it in proportion? So for that you can hold shift key on your keyboard again. Drag your mouse first and then hold shift key to get this in proportions, and release your mouse first and then release the shift key. Again, if you release the key before your mouse, then you may lose your proportionate shape. So what I mean by that, if let's say your cursor is here somewhere, and see, you can see my cursor is not at the exact position of this point, but still I'm getting a proportionate resizing. Now if I release shift before releasing my mouse click, so immediately you can see it jumped back to my cursor position. So at this moment, if I release my mouse, then I don't have a proportionate resizing. So for that I have to release my mouse click first and then release the shift key. So that's how it will work. Okay, so that's all with the navigation and scaling options. Now if I want to create new artboard, what can I do? One option we have seen is we can make a rectangle anywhere, and from here we can say convert to artboard. Oh, the rectangle was already in white color. So let us choose another color. Okay, so one option is that I can create a rectangle and from artboard panel, and there I can convert it to artboard. So I have my new artboard here. Now the other option I get with artboard tool is I can just click and drag and create new artboards. Now you can easily notice that how convenient it is above other options we have learned so far. You can just click and drag of any size and there is no problem at all. Moreover, if you want to change the size later, then you can just go and change it from here, or you have your bounding box, so you can be very precise and be very accurate about your new size. So yeah, now I have so many artboards created over here and I actually wanted to delete them. So to delete any artboard using artboard tool, you can just click on this cross icon. See, you get this icon only when you have your artboard tool selected. This time I have my selection tool selected and there's nothing on any of these artboards. So when I select this artboard tool, immediately I get artboard name and a cross icon on the top right of every artboard. So when I click on any of this icon, it just deletes that artboard. It's as simple as that. Click on the icon and delete the artboard. There we go. Now again, we have our, I think, 6-7 artboards over here. Let's delete this one also. Alright. So there we go. We have covered all the options, on-screen options of the artboard tool. Now we have few of the options present here above, which is option bar. So actually we haven't covered option bar so far because it makes more sense when we learn about tool. So let us see what all options do we have in option bar for artboard tool. So first of all, let's select any of this artboard. Make sure we have our artboard in focus or in screen. No, in focus was better. So just trim in screen. Okay. Yeah. Alright. So first of all, we have our presets over here. So we can go and select any of these presets like we were doing in artboard options. So there's nothing new about it. It's just like the previous one. You can select any of this preset and it will change immediately. So I am just, for the sake of some change, I'm just gonna go and change it to A4. Now one mistake I have done is I didn't save the last day file, day 4 file, where we made those beautiful shapes on those artboards, the star, rounded, rectangle and all that. I could have saved that file. It would have made it more clear. Now you have all these white screens all over the place, but I didn't save the file. And again, I don't want to waste so much of time again in creating the same shape. So this time I'm just gonna cover along with the white artboard. Sorry, you have to bear with me for that. Okay, so now the other option we have here is the portrait and the landscape mode. So like the word says, you can switch back between portrait and landscape modes here. Again, next I have this new artboard icon or button which I can click, and how it works differently. Actually, it doesn't create new artboard immediately like it used to do with artboard panels, where it just immediately create a artboard, new artboard next to your previous artboards. Here what it does is when you click on the button, it gives you a fake image, you can say, or a ghost image of that artboard, the new artboard. So you have your options here where you want to place it, and you let's say I want to place it here. So you can just click it and your new artboard will be positioned here. So you actually get the freedom to place your newly created artboard here, and that is really nice. So let me just delete it or undo. I just undoed the I just pressed Ctrl Z to undo. Then we have our delete button over here. So yes, you can delete from here and you can delete from here. Like I was saying, there are several ways to do same thing in Illustrator. So yeah, just delete it from here and we have our artboard deleted. Now one thing, if you notice that If I select this artboard and I click on new, so I have artboard of this size, new artboard of this size. I mean, artboard one copied size. And when I select artboard one and click on new, so I have my artboard of B4 size. So yeah, that made it very clear that when I create a new artboard, it is going to copy the exact same dimensions of my previously selected artboard. So that means if I have any small artboard selected and I create a new artboard, so the new artboard will be exactly of this same size. And if I have this bigger artboard selected here and I click a new artboard, then the new artboard will be of this size. So yeah, now we can we have this name field over here. So like it says, and I think it is very clear by now, we can rename our artboard from here. Let's say renamed artboard. I'm just saying any name over here, and immediately it got reflected over here. And let's name this artboard one. No, day five. Now, just before the name, let me zoom in real quick over here. Okay, it's still small, so it won't help much. Okay, so just before the name here, let's say day five. There's a letter. There's a number called which says 01. So it is like 01 dash day 5. Same here, it says 04 dash renamed artboard. So this numbering in beginning, which says 0104, actually defines the artboard position. So let's say day 5 artboard is at first position, so it says 01 here, whereas day renamed artboard is at fourth position, so that's why it says 04 over here. Now I can click and move these artboards position from artboard panel. This you can only do from artboard panel, you cannot do it from artboard tool. So let's say I moved it to second position, and here we have our number updation which says 02 renamed artboard. So yeah, that is very clear, that is very easy to understand even. So let's move on and see what this option can do. Move copy artwork with artboard. So yeah, it says very clearly that if I uncheck this, I will not be able to move my artwork along with my artboard. So let us quickly draw a rectangle over here. Why draw a rectangle all the time? This time we'll draw a star. Yeah. And let's place it over here on this artboard. Okay. So let's select our artboard tool and move the artboard. So you can see my shape is moving along with the artboard like it should have. Because if I have my design on the artboard, then it is preferable that my design moves along with the artboard, so that I need not to reposition my artwork array again and again. But if I uncheck this button which says move and copy artwork with artboard, then when I'm moving my artboard, it left my design behind. So it depends on you, it depends on the kind of work you are doing. So if you just want to keep your work at single place and you don't want it to be disturbed, and you have like a linked something linked from multiple artboards and you don't want to change your shape's position, then this you can turn off this option. Otherwise you can just click on this option and it will move your artwork along with the artboard. Okay. So let me just delete this artboard. Oh, I haven't covered this option. So to delete an artboard, you can either press, you can just select an artboard and press delete on your keyboard also. That will also work. But again, it will leave all the stuff you have drawn on that artboard. So that stuff you have to delete manually. Okay. Now let's move on. And here we have all these three options, which says show center mark, and then show crosshair. This crosshair around the artboard, center mark is at the center of the artboard. And then we have this safe frame for every artboard. We can turn it for individual artboards as per our requirement. So let me turn it off real quick. And then we have this button which will open the artboard options. I think by this time we don't need this artboard options because we all have all these options covered already in here in our option panel. But still, if you want to use it, then yeah, you have option for it. You have option to open this window over here. And now there's this thing which is called a reference point. Now this thing is little tricky actually. So let's bring up rulers first to understand this and locate our center position, which says 0, 0. Okay, so here it says 0 and 0 over here. So I'm just marking the 0 position. I'm just gonna delete this artboard for now because it's coming in the way. And even this one, I don't need this right now. Even this one actually. And let's just move this artboard. We'll have only single artboard for this example, and name it reference example. Okay. All right. Now 0, 0 position has changed. This is gonna be tricky. I have to create another artboard over here. There is no way. So that's how it will work only. Okay, now to understand the reference point, let's select this tool. And now it says reference point is at the center. You can see this dot is selected, the centered one. I can select any of this dot and immediately that dot gets highlighted. So right now the center one is selected. That means my reference point is here somewhere. Okay. And when I select this one, the top left one, that means the reference point is here somewhere. Okay, and the same applies to the bottom left, the bottom right, bottom left and everywhere. But whenever I'm changing the reference point, you can notice the difference in X position over here and the Y position. So whenever I'm changing some reference point, you can see my X position has changed from 2.6 to 2.6 to 5.2, and my Y position has changed from 3 to 6. Now why these values are changing actually? So what is happening when I'm selecting the reference point as center? So it is saying that my center is 2.6 inch away from x-axis. This horizontal is called the x-axis. And this vertical is called the y-axis. So when it says 2.6 inch, that means my center is 2.6 inch away from y-axis. Sorry, when I say x, it's not x, it's y-axis. So my center is 2.6 inch away from y-axis and 3 inch in y. That means my center, this artboard center, is 3 inch away from x-axis. So as even if we draw guides to the center, let's say we'll just draw, okay. Like I was saying, you should have your selection tool selected for that. And here is the center, I believe. Okay, yeah. And let's select our artboard tool. So we have our center position marked, and when we go back and retrack it to the ruler, it says around some 2 point something, and it is 2.6 inch. And in the Y, when we, sorry, this is 2.6. When we retract the X position, it says 2.6. And when we retract the Y position, it says around 3, 2, 3, and 4. Okay. So that's how this actually, it defines where my center position is. When I click the top left one, now it says 0, 0, because it is considering this top left corner as my reference point. And now my reference point is exactly at 0 and 0 position. So that's how I'm getting these values. And when I select the bottom right corner, so let's draw some two more rulers, and let me deselect this tool first and select the selection tool and drag our rulers. Okay, so now you can see our position is like the Y value is like 6 and the X value is like 4 point something. I think it's 5.2 or something. So let's see how much value. Yeah, it's 5.2 in the x and 6 in the y. So that's how this reference thing works. So I hope it is clear to you. If not, then you can, first of all, I think you should experiment it by yourself. When you see actually value changes on the screen, and it will be more beneficial to you when you experiment this thing by yourself. So just go and experiment by yourself, and it should be very clear to you. Okay, one more thing actually I just did, I want to address it. When I have my artboard tool selected and I'm just dragging a guide from ruler, and when I drop it somewhere here, so let's say here, yeah, so you can see that my guide is only limiting to this artboard because I have my artboard tool selected. So if something like this happens to you, so that means you have to actually see this guide is only till this artboard. It's not going further on the next artboard. So if something like that happens, then you have to select your selection tool and then draw a guide again. So then it will be like a common along all the artboards. So when you have your artboard tool selected, the guide works only for that particular artboard. And if you don't have any artboard in between, then it will just go for infinite space. Okay. So let me just delete these guides real quick, and we have our reference point understood. Coming next to this x, y positions, we have already understood them, and we can even change these values from here. Oh, I just pressed 100, I don't know where it went. So let me press 10 instead, and yeah, we can change these values from here. That works the same way like in artboard options. And again, we can change the y value. For advanced control, you have your width and height fields here. You can just go and change your width and height from here, let's say 5.9, and there you go. You have your value reflected. But I actually like this thing more than changing values from here, because I get this live preview. I get this ghosting type of information which says me how my future next sorry how my updated artboard will look like. So I like this. I prefer this more than this thing. And again, we have this lock icon here, which will scale everything in proportion. Sorry, not from here. From here only. 6, 7, and yeah, everything is in proportion. You can uncheck it again to have your proportions off and. Let's see if I say 10. Okay. If I say 10. So yeah, there's one more thing we can cover in reference point over here is that when I'm rescaling my artboard from this width and height panel, field, so I can decide my reference point. Where should it be? Let's say if reference point is top left corner. And I am rescaling or resizing my artboard. Let's say this time I say 10 in what say it is width, so 10 in width, and I press enter. So this time my artboard has resized from this point. And when I select center as my reference point, and this time I'm pressing 10, so you can see it has scaled from this, it expanded all the way through from all the sides. And when I select the bottom left corner, so this time you can guess that it will start resizing from here and it will go all the way up to this much. So let's just do it. Okay, so it worked as expected, and let us undo it, and I'm just gonna close this file for now because that's all we can cover in artboard. There might be few things which I have missed, but this information is more than enough to keep you going for like anything. If you want to do anything with artboard, this information is more than enough to change anything in your artboard and modify them the way you want. Okay, so let us create a new file with a single artboard, and let's have A4 size selected. I'm going to select pixels as my units and press OK. Alright, so now it's time to learn how to draw stuff in Illustrator. So, if you want to draw a rectangle, then you can do is select this one. There's a rectangle tool, or there's a rectangle shape over here. You can click on this one. So let's say just click on this and you have your rectangle tool selected. The shortcut key for this one is M. So you can press M on your keyboard also. And now you have your rectangle tool selected. You can just click and drag to create a rectangle. Again, like we were doing an artboard, if you want to scale in proportion, then you have to hold shift. The same thing applies here. The same rule applies here. While dragging, if you press shift, then you have your rectangle in proportionate. Okay, so how does it work? Click and drag first and then press shift to make it in proportion. Then release your mouse and then release shift key to have your proportionate rectangle. Or actually this is a square more than a proportionate rectangle. It is a square actually. Okay, so yeah, so that's how you can create a rectangle. Now if you want to fill some color in it, then you have these two boxes around here. This one is for fill, which says fill X, and this one is for outline, which says stroke. Click to activate, or I can press X also. So X is for switching between color and outline, and let's just fill some color in it. So to fill it, I just have to double click on this icon, on this box actually, and there I go. I have my color picker over here, and I can go and pick any of this color. On this vertical bar, if you move, it will change the hue. On this square, if you move, it will change the brightness and saturation level, or you can say the purity and brightness, I think. Yeah, so you can change those values from here. Okay, so if I'm going for pure red over here, I can go to here. If I want to reduce the brightness, then I get to absolute dark over here, and this includes the white in it. I'm increasing the brightness over here, and this is like I'm reducing the saturation level, and it goes absolutely gray on the exact on the very left side. Okay, and let's say I select this gray and a little bit of red tint in it and press OK. So I have this color fill in it now. Now to fill a color, you need to have your shape selected. Now how to select your shape? You have to use your selection tool and select any of this shape. So you have your shape selected and then double click on the fill and click any and select any of the color you want, and it will be reflected back to your shape. Okay, now if I want to change outline of the shape, all I can do is click on this shape again, select this first, and then you have your this outline box here. Then just double click on this one and select your outline. So let's say this is our outline. Now it is not visible very clearly here. Let me zoom in real quick, and there you have your outline reflected. If I want to change the color to something else, and okay, now nothing has happened, and you should have guessed by now, I mean, why it didn't change, because I didn't select my shape at all. So I have to select my shape, and then only when I change color, it will be reflected back to my shape. Okay, so I'm zooming out. Now, what if I want to increase this outline width? Like I want to make this outline really thick. So for that, you first have to select your shape and then go here in the option bar. You have this stroke thing. So you can click and click on this drop down and select any of this value. So let's say 14. So I have this real thick outline now. You can either click and these are the options. You can either click on this up arrow key or this down arrow key to increase and decrease the width of the outline. So right now I'll just select 4, or actually I should select 10. 10 looks good. Okay, so this is about round. This is about rectangle. Now let's move on to next shape, which is called rounded rectangle. So to select rounded rectangle, you have to click and hold on this icon first. on this rectangle icon, if you click and hold, it will open a sub menu, and from here you can select the rounded rectangle. Okay, so it's as easy as that. Click and hold and then select the rounded rectangle. Now this works for so many tools over here. For all these tools who have this small bottom right icon, bottom right arrow, it is a sign that this will open a submenu. So I can click on any of that and it will open a submenu for me. The tools which have this bottom right white icon on them, or a sort of arrow actually. So okay, let's select the rounded rectangle and let's click and drag to create a rounded rectangle here, and there we have a rounded rectangle. Now it copied the color information and the stroke information from the previous object, and that's how Illustrator works. It copies the previous information, it copies the information of previous shape and applies it to newly created shape. Okay, so like in rectangle, we can draw proportionate, or we can draw a square from rounded rectangle also. Just click and drag, and when you release, you have your square with rounded rectangle. Now there is one thing in rounded rectangle. If I want to change this corner radius, how can I do that? So to do that, you have to press up arrow key and down arrow key on your keyboard. So when I press down arrow key, it becomes very sharp. When I press up arrow key, this corner radius values increases, and it can be a circle too. You can make a circle out of it. But again, it's why we don't do that. We'll come to that when we learn about anchor points and all that stuff. For right now, just press down arrow key and get back to some decent corner radius. Let's say this much. Okay. So this looks good. Now a word of caution. Sometimes it may happen. Actually, this happened with me a lot. When I drew a rounded rectangle, then let's say you pressed up arrow key and you pressed it really long. You didn't even leave that key for at all. So let's say so far I have pressed up arrow key and now I'm releasing the up arrow key. Now the corner radius has increased to a significant value right now. If you draw this much big rounded rectangle, even see here, I'm not able to see my corner radius at all. So I don't know how big shape I had to draw. Okay, so this is the value I have achieved so far. Now if you go to a shape like this much and even smaller than this, you won't even notice that what is actually happening. So let's get back to our artboard, and I will tell you what I was trying to say. Okay, now when you draw your rounded rectangle and you are pressing down arrow key to make corner sharp, now it won't reflect changes at all, because the value has changed to such an extent that it will take a lot of time to come back to zero. So now it has reflected. So if something like that happens, then you can keep pressing your down arrow key until you get this sharp corners, and again you can adjust it the way you want. Or you can just go and draw a very big rounded rectangle and see whether the value actually has changed to such an extent, such a big extent or not. So okay, so we have covered how to change the corner radius of rounded rectangle. Okay, now let's see how this ellipse tool works. So this is ellipse tool over here. The shortcut key is L for that. Again, you have this like this arrow over here and this bar. When you click on this, it deattaches from the toolbar. So again, you can dock it anywhere, and you have this your sub tool. Actually, you get this as a panel now. So you can easily select any of the shapes from here. This is also convenient, but I don't like this because it covers too much of space. So I like selecting it from here. This is more convenient for me. Again, it depends on, your personal choice. So yeah, let me just delete these shapes. I don't need them. And just control zero for press control zero for fit to the screen, and select the ellipse tool. and draw ellipse. So again, you can click and drag to create any kind of ellipse you want. If you want a circle, perfect circle, you can press shift key and it will draw a perfect circle for you. And there we go. When you release the mouse and release the shift key, you have your perfect circle along with all the color information which you applied to the previous object. And this is how we can create the circle. If you want to create some ellipse and ovals, you can do this. You can just draw and drag without even holding shift. So you will have your multiple circles. Okay, so like you can draw a Mickey Mouse over here like this. So how cool is that? Okay, now let's see how can we change the center position now, or the reference point actually. So for artboards, we have seen the reference point, how does it work. Now let's see for shapes, how does it work. So let's say if I'm drawing a rectangle from this top left corner and I click and drag from here. Now it is creating a rectangle actually from the top left corner and it's moving all the way down. And you can see there is a small cross here and there is a small cross icon at the center of my rectangle right now. This is the center point of the rectangle. Now when I press Alt, the center point shifts to my initial position from where I started drawing rectangle. So let me go over here and then we'll draw. So you can notice now I can draw it from my center position of my rectangle and the values will be symmetric around. So yeah, it's as simple as that. That's how it works. And you can again hold shift key to make it a square and then release the mouse, release shift and alt key, and there you go. Now the same applies for rounded rectangle also. Let's draw it from here and I'm holding the alt key to change the reference point and again holding the shift key to make it a perfect square, and there I release everything. Now mouse click, alt key and shift key, and this time let's try with the ellipse tool. So as expected, it should work just fine. Now release the mouse click and then release both keys, shift and alt. So there we have our option, one more option covered, how we can modify or how we can have a better control over our shapes when drawing. Okay, so now I have all these shapes scattered around and I want to move them. So to move them, you need to select your selection tool. The shortcut key is V, and so far we know that if we click on any of the shape, it will select the shape. Now if you want to move the shape, you can just click and drag on the shape and it will just work fine. You just need not, you can even avoid clicking on the shape before, you can just click and drag directly and it will work the way it should. Okay, I am just repositioning these shapes over here and there we go. Okay, this is not a very nice arrangement, but I had to do something. Okay, so press Ctrl 0 again for fit to screen. And now if I want to resize my shapes, so what all you can do is you have this bounding box again around the shapes, like just like when we learned the artboard tool, we had this bounding box around artboards. So this time we are getting this kind of bounding box around the shapes. So it works exactly the same way like it used to work with artboards. You can either scale it horizontally or vertically, and then you can click on any of these corner points and scale it the way you want. Now this is scaling, this is not resizing. So you can actually see that your stroke has also changed its width along with the shape. So this is scaling. Okay, so now you can click and drag to scale it in any direction. And if you want to scale it in proportion, then you have to press shift key and it will scale in proportions. And again, you can release your mouse click and then release the shift key to have these values reflected. Press Ctrl 0 again. And also you can click and drag to select multiple shapes from here. So let's say if I click and drag, There is this rectangular box that follows my cursor when I click and drag. So any shape touches this rectangular thing will be selected. So let's say right now these three shapes are touching this rectangular thing, or not even touching, even include inside this will be selected. So let's say I just drag this rectangle to this much, and I am releasing my mouse, so it selected all these three shapes. Now I can move all these three shapes together, and I can click and drag to scale them, either in proportions or without proportions, anything will work. Okay, and delete. So we have our selection tool covered, and yeah, like in artboard tool, if you want to duplicate stuff, you can just click alt and drag, and it will make a copy of that shape. So click and drag while holding alt key on your keyboard, so it will duplicate that shape for you. Now again, you can just click and delete all of these things, select and delete. Okay, and I'm scaling it down a bit. Now, like we have seen that while holding shift key for creating rectangle and creating different shapes, how does it work? So it actually works with so many tools. There are few keys like shift, alt, control key, which works with almost every tool, and it works in a different way. So what all you can do is, I'm going to cover all these options in the videos, but what all you can do is, while creating something, or while implementing something, or experimenting something, you can just keep pressing shift control keys or alt keys, and you will come to know about so many options that you will see. So yeah, just keep that in mind, and let's see the implementation of shift key when we have our selection tool selected. So this time I'm dragging around and I'm holding shift. So now you can see I can only either move my circle in a horizontal direction, or in a 45 degree direction, or in a 45 degree direction, or in a vertical direction. So like previously I had full control of dragging it anywhere around, but this time I want very limited control. I just want to make a copy around horizontal space. So that's how I can do. What I have just done is hold alt and click and drag. While dragging, you can press shift key to copy, or moving it in just single axis, and release mouse and release both the keys. So that's how it works. Now this time, along with selection tool, the alt and shift key works in a different way. But when I select this rectangle tool and I press shift key, then I get this proportionate or I get this square, and when I press alt key, then I have my center repositioned. So it works differently with every tool, and it is actually very confusing initially, and it is hard to track, but over the time it's more like you can say it's a muscle memory, when you just know how it's gonna work because you have practiced so much. So don't worry about it if you're confused right now. Just keep learning, and over the time you will be very proficient with all this, and you won't even notice that you are actually putting effort in thinking how it is working. It will just be automatic. So I'm just gonna select this shape and delete, and select this shape and delete, and let's see some of the color options we have with us. So I just drew, or I just created a square, and here we have our color picker. So I'm just gonna cover a few things about this color picker right now. For detail, we will cover this color theory and all the color options we have in Illustrator in future videos. Okay. So like I said, this box can change the brightness and saturation level of the color, and here we can change our hue. Hue means the color value actually, and brightness means this addition of black and white, and saturation is this inclusion of this gray. So it's actually like you are losing the purity of your color over here. So it's become grayish more and more you move to the left. Okay, now you have like this two values over here, which reflects your current value of the color and the previous value. So let's say my previous value was this one. There's a kind of blue color over here, but when I go and double click and I change my value a bit, now I can see the newly updated color which I am going to select. So it is good that I come to know the difference between my previously selected color and my newly selected color, especially when you are trying something or you are experimenting with new colors, then it is really helpful in that case. Okay, now we have these values over here. So what are all these? Let's quickly go through all of them. So H is for hue, S is for saturation, B is for brightness, R is for red, G is for green, and B is for blue. Now we have our CMYK over here, which says C for cyan, M for magenta, Y for yellow, and K for key. Now this key is called the black color, but we name it key. I don't know why. I am yet to find a reason for it. So anyways, now we have this radio button before all these letters. So what it does is actually it changes the arrangement of all these colors. So when I have this hue selected as my active color option, then the primary mode of operation or primary mode of control is the hue. So I can change hue, and then I can change its brightness and saturation level. Then when I select the saturation as my primary control, then I can change saturation here, and according to it I can change the color level, color value, and it works both way. I mean it's vice versa. You can change it from here first and then change it from here. It depends on you. But I just want to address how it changes the primary control of your color options. So when I change it to brightness, so you here you have your brightness option, and then you have this all the variation of colors which can be done in the under the same brightness level. And when you select your red color, so it orients mainly around red, and same is for green and same is for blue. Now it doesn't provide control for CMYK, and I don't know why, but there you have all your options. And I mainly worked on hue and saturation based schemes. I have never tried this brightness RGB because it's just my personal choice. I mean, I just find it more comfortable to work with these two rather than this one. You might find this more comfortable than something else. It totally depends on person to person. Okay. So with that, now we have these values also changing along with whenever we change something, we have these values change. So it is a good option available here. You can just copy and paste these values if you want to duplicate your color. And at the bottom, you have this color code. Now, right now it is FF0000. When I change the hue and I change my brightness and saturation level to something else, then this value changes. So you can, let's say if you are duplicating colors across different software, so you don't have a color picker there to pick from software to software. So what you can do is actually copy this color value and go and paste the same color value to different software, and you will have exactly the same color. Or if that software doesn't support this color value, you can note this RGB value, and you can make this color in another software using this RGB values. So like this, we have this hue, saturation, brightness, and these values also. It is good to know that we have all these options, and in case we need them, we can use them in any way we want. That's all with the color picker. I'm not going to cover color swatches over here. We will cover it in future chapters. And there's this thing out of web color warning, auto correction, and when I select some color like this, I get this warning. This all we will cover when we cover about color theory. So we will not worry about these things right now. Just feel free to experiment with colors the way you want. Now we have this checkbox over here which says only web color. So when I click on this, I have this limited color information for the web. So yeah, it's a good option to know. I don't use it much because I have rarely worked on web. So I haven't used this much. But I actually worked on this because I I create a lot of illustrations and cartoons, and you need really bright colors in that. I haven't used that color much. Okay, but it's good to know that you have this option, and it looks really good when you switch your hues from here. I think so. Okay, anyways, let's press cancel over here, and I think that's all for this chapter. Again, we haven't covered grouping and ungrouping and lock and hiding the objects. Again, we are running short of time. I think I'm just putting too much of content in a single chapter. So from future chapters, I'll just reduce it a bit so that we can cover exactly what we have written in the beginning. So anyways, we will cover grouping and locking and hiding the objects in future chapter. Along with that, I think we'll learn layers, because that's the only thing, or that's the only technical thing that is left in Illustrator. Other than that, all left is just drawing tools and how can you create your stuff and all that thing. So yeah, that's all for this video, and I will see you in the next video. Goodbye for now.